When purchasing a new mountain bike, the question that typically goes to the top of the list is, should I get a hardtail or a full suspension? And what's the main differences? In this video, I'm going to attempt to answer those questions by showing you the difference between the two bikes and giving you some buying tips. Let's first go over what a hardtail is. And if you're a more experienced mountain biker, just hang with me for a minute and I'll cover this from the real basics and get a little bit more complex as we go along. A hardtail is a bike that has no suspension in the back. There's no shock, there's no pivots, everything is firm. As opposed to a full suspension, where there is a shock, there's pivots, which allows the rear wheel to absorb bumps. When you talk about a hardtail, you typically refer to a bike that has a suspension fork. A bike with no suspension at all is commonly referred to as a rigid bike, meaning that there is no suspension fork and no rear suspension in the back. Hardtails are typically used for cross-country type riding. That is riding that does not involve a lot of big jumps and a lot of drops. Now, there are dirt jump bikes for tracks that have a lot of jumps, but the terrain is relatively smooth, and think of a BMX track. Full suspension bikes cover a much wider variety of riding, from cross-country to less aggressive trail riding, more aggressive trail riding, up to free ride type riding and downhill. Hardtails can also move beyond cross country and go into trail type riding, especially with the bigger wheel sizes, such as this 29er. 29ers allow the bumps to be a little bit smoother because the angle of attack over the bumps is a little bit more shallow than a smaller wheel size. Most hardtails will have a fork that's between 80 to 120 millimeters of travel. There are a few anomalies out there, bike companies that are making all mountain type hardtails with long travel forks, 140 up to 160 millimeters of travel. Again, those are kind of outliers in the bike world, but most hardtails are again designed for cross country with a shorter travel fork. Full suspension bikes typically go from 100 millimeters of travel, both in the front and in the rear, all the way up to 8 inches of travel for a downhill bike. A trail bike full suspension typically goes between 120 millimeters of travel up to 160. Trail bikes probably cover the widest range of riding because they are very versatile bikes. They can go on really smooth single track up to pretty rough, pretty aggressive type riding. Some people may wonder how a hardtail even works as a mountain bike, because you don't see cars with suspension only in the front. You don't see motorcycles typically with suspension only in the front. And if mountain bikes are designed to cover rough terrain, rocks and roots and that kind of thing, how is it that a hardtail can work? The reason is because the rider on a hardtail is able to shift his weight around to absorb the bumps. When you go over a bump, when your front wheel hits the bump, your weight is behind the obstacle that you're hitting. Once your back wheel goes over the obstacle, your weight is already past it. So the front wheel gets pushed over a bump and the rear wheel gets pulled over a bump. That allows the rear wheel to bounce up a little bit better and give you a little bit more control than if the front wheel hit an obstacle with no suspension. And just as a side note, that's the reason why controlling the front wheel is so important when riding a mountain bike. Your rear wheel can slide around a little bit and you're going to be fine. If your front wheel slides, then you have a more likely chance of falling. Controlling the front wheel is very important, and typically what happens to the front wheel will happen to you. If a front wheel really gets hung up on a bump, there's a much better chance that you're going to endo. Again, with the rear wheel, if it hangs up a little bit, you can usually pull it off because, again, your weight is already past the object and you're pulling the rear wheel over. So riding a hardtail, you're going to have to get out of the saddle more. And I'll talk more about the fatiguing factor of a hardtail versus full suspension in a few minutes. But you have to use a little bit more body English and be a little bit more attentive on a hardtail than you would be on a full suspension. And that is why oftentimes I recommend a hardtail to new riders, because a hardtail teaches you and forces you to be a better rider. You can get away with more stuff and get a little bit lazy on a full suspension, whereas a hardtail forces you to develop those skills. Let's go into the benefits of a hardtail. First of all, typically they're going to be a lower price point than a full suspension. Obviously, that's because you don't have the shock and the moving pivot, so there's less hardware. Most hardtails are going to be about $700 to $1,300 less than an equally specced full suspension bike. And let me give you an example. The 2015 Specialized Epic Expert retails for $6,300. The Stump Jumper Hardtail Expert is $5,000. Those have about the same components on them, whereas the full suspension is $1,300 more. Another example is the Giant XTC Advanced 2751. That is a $4,125 hardtail. The Giant Anthem Advanced 2751 has pretty much the same components, and that costs $4,850. So that's a $725 difference. With most mainstream bike companies, you're going to need to spend about $2,000 to get a decent full suspension bike, one that's I would classify as a real mountain bike. If you're going to, if your budget is below $2,000, you really need to go with a hardtail so you can get something that's durable, that's relatively light, and that's going to be a real mountain bike made by a real mountain biking company. So the lowest amount of money that you can really spend on a hardtail is about $600 to get a real mountain bike. On my YouTube channel, I reviewed a Giant Talon, which comes in, they started about $600, and that's a good example of a pretty low budget bike that's still gonna be a good quality ride. Another benefit to a hardtail is gonna be lower maintenance. You don't have the pivots that need to be serviced or the shock. The shock on a full suspension bike is going to need some routine maintenance. It's really not that hard. I do have a service video on my channel that shows you how to do that. But about every 30 to 40 hours of riding, you've got to take the shock off the bike, remove the sleeve, just kind of clean everything up, pull a little bit of oil back in and put it back together. Really, it only takes me about 20 minutes to do, and that also includes getting it off the bike. So it's not that bad, but with a hardtail, you don't have to worry about that. And that comes really true if you ride in really muddy, really nasty conditions, because pivots can get dirt in them. Pivots have gotten so much better. The bearings are sealed. Some of them have bushings. This is a bearing bike with bearing pivots. And so you can get dirt inside of them, but since they're sealed, unless you just really have a total mud, total rain day, you can probably go 6 months to a year without having to take the pivots apart. The bearings do wear out. It takes quite a while and quite a bit of riding. If you ride frequently, you can go at least a year or more between actually having to clean the bearings. But that is something that you're going to have to consider when getting a full suspension bike. Another benefit to a hardtail is that it will be lower weight than a full suspension of the same frame material, same components, wheels, tires, that kind of thing. On average, a hardtail is going to be about 2 pounds lighter than an equivalent full suspension. Now, that weight savings is going to vary as far as how much it benefits you, depending on what type of riding that you do. On climbs, you're going to be able to climb faster, most likely on a full suspension. Now, if the terrain is really rough and traction is important, then a lot of times a full suspension is going to be faster on a climb. And I'll talk about racing in a minute, but the reason a lot of racers choose a hardtail is because it is about 2 pounds lighter than a full suspension. Another benefit is going to be that it has a firm pedaling platform. And what I mean by that is the rear end is pretty stiff when you crank on the pedals, and it's not going to bob like a full suspension bike would. And when a full suspension bike bobs, that means that the suspension actually compresses down and absorbs some of your energy. Now, a lot of modern full suspensions, especially with the virtual pivot style suspension designs, this is the Giant Maestro, does a really good job of not absorbing your pedaling energy. But on a hardtail, 100% of your pedaling energy goes into the drivetrain and accelerates the bike forward. And that's really good, again, for climbing, but also for sprinting. A lot of people like a firm platform too when going around corners. The hardtail kind of springs in and out of corners because the suspension is not there to be compressed. And one final benefit I'll mention is a lot of times a hardtail is a better workout. So if you're just riding for fitness and you want to get some really good upper body strength, you know, you've got to work harder on a hardtail. You're in and out of the saddle more. You have to use your body more, and that does really work and strengthen your upper body and back maybe a little bit more than a full suspension bike would. Now let's talk about the benefits of a full suspension. It's going to be more comfortable and less fatiguing than a hardtail. The hardtail requires you to get out of the saddle a lot over bumps because you're using your legs to absorb bumps on a hardtail. So every time you get out of the saddle, you're raising your weight up and using your legs to get your weight up, and you're also using your weight, your legs to absorb the bumps. So over a long ride, a hardtail can be very fatiguing compared to a full suspension. And even on larger bumps, when you're out of the saddle on a full suspension, the bike is just absorbing the hits more than a hardtail. So less of the shock of the bump you're going over carries into your body. Again, even when you're out of the saddle on the full suspension. You're going to be faster on a descent on a full suspension. Part of that is because of the control that you get. Another part is because of the braking performance. And what happens is on a full suspension, when you apply the brakes, the tire stays glued to the trail a lot better. Because on a hardtail, when you hit a bump, especially when you're going fast, the rear tire is going to skip up. It's going to bounce up off the trail, and that's going to momentarily cause the tire to not connect with the trail, and you're going to lose braking performance. So you get more control, better braking on a full suspension bike. And not only on descending, but on really rough terrain, even when it's flatter, a lot of times you're going to be faster on a full suspension. So you're going to have more control in rough terrain on the full suspension bike. And I mentioned the traction when braking. You also get good traction when cornering on a full squish bike because, again, the tire is able to really stay glued to the trail and not skip up like a hardtail. Now let me discuss the type of riding that a hardtail and a full suspension is better at. First of all, let's go to racing. When racing in the mountains, a lot of time a hardtail is going to be the better choice because you can make up more time on a climb than you could on a descent. So if the track is not very rough, where you don't need the extra traction that a full suspension would give you on climbs, you can typically get up faster. One, because the weight is lower, and two, because of the really firm pedaling platform. And when you jump out of the saddle, like I said earlier, all of your power is going to go right to the drivetrain. Now, this may sound counterintuitive, but I've found that I'm actually faster on flatter terrain on a full suspension bike because, for example, where I live has lots of roots, and so I'm able to stay in the saddle and really power and crank over those roots than getting out and getting bounced around. And so most of the time, my lap times are faster on a full suspension bike. Trail riding is the term used to cover most of the type of riding that mountain bikers do. And trail riding covers a wide variety of conditions, from rolling terrain rough and chunky terrain. It can be flat, it can be lots of climbs and descents. It's the type of bike that I think most people are going to ride. Trail bikes range from 120 to 160 millimeters of travel, and I've got a video that really talks about the difference between cross-country and trail bikes. I'm not going to go into that here. But for most trail-type applications, the full suspension bike is going to be the way to go because, again, it's a lot of variety. You may not know what type of terrain you're going to encounter on a ride, or you may want a bike that just does everything, from rough trails with long descents to just, you know, your local trails that may be more rolling and flatter. So again, trail bikes generally are full suspension bikes. That doesn't mean a hardtail can't make a good trail bike. It's going to take a little bit more work. It may be more fatiguing, but it's going to be a bike that can still cover a lot of variety. And you may not be as fast or on the descents, and it may not be quite as fun because you're having to work harder. But a 29er hardtail especially is a pretty versatile bike. And I had mentioned fatigue earlier as a factor in less fatigue on a full suspension bike. And if you've had back problems, you probably are going to want to go with a full suspension bike. A lot of that shock that would go into your spine gets absorbed by the bike. Now, I've ridden with guys who have had back problems and like a hardtail better because they're out of the saddle a lot more. But I think generally, if you've had back problems, especially if you've ever had back surgery, you are probably going to want to lean towards a full suspension bike. So let me wrap this up by giving some buying advice out there. And I've mentioned a few things, but let me mention a few more things and sum up some of the points that I've made. Two of the most important factors when buying a bike is your budget and the type of riding you're going to do. Like I mentioned before, if your budget is more or less than $2,000, unless you're buying used, you're probably going to want to get a hardtail. The type of terrain that you ride is very important to consider also when you're buying a bike. So if you ride in really rough terrain with lots of rocks and roots, that kind of thing, you're going to be somewhat limited on a hardtail. Doesn't mean you can't do it, but you're going to be somewhat limited in how fast you can ride and how much control you're going to have. Now, if you're buying a bike that's going to be a commuter type bike, a dirt road, a gravel road type bike, a mountain bike, then most likely you're going to want to get a hardtail. Hardtails are a lot better on roads and dirt roads generally than a full suspension bike. Now for racing, I made some pretty good points earlier, so I won't go too much into that, but it's going to depend on how smooth or how rough the terrain is that you ride, and also if you ride a lot in mountains or on flatter terrain. And the last point I'll talk about is wheel size, because that does come into play depending on what type of bike you're gonna choose. Most of the time for hardtails, I recommend a 29er. The only reason I wouldn't is because maybe you're really short or you ride in super tight trails. But even still, 29ers have pretty short chain stays, and chain stays is the length of this bar right here. The shorter that bar is, the better the bike's gonna handle, the more agile it's gonna be. The problem with 29er full suspension bikes is especially when the travel gets more suspension travel, those chain stays get longer and the bike's harder to manage. But with a hardtail 29er, they're able to get the chain stays still pretty short, which makes the bike handle very well, even with the big wheels. So again, if you're choosing a hardtail, generally I'm going to recommend that you go with a 29er. Now, for full suspension, it's really going to depend on the type of riding that you do, your height, that kind of thing. For cross-country bikes and cross-country race bikes, generally I think a 27.5 is going to be good if you ride tight trails, so lots of turns and that kind of thing. If your trails are more wide open, I think a 29er is probably going to be the way to go. 29ers are very stable at speed, if you're not turning a lot. I ride a lot of tight trails, and I prefer the 27.5. It's not as cut and dry for cross-country full suspension as far as 27.5 or 29er. My recommendation is try to get a test ride, ride a buddy's bike, that kind of thing. If you can ride both wheel sizes, I think that's going to be the way to go, because that's really a matter of preference. Now for trail bikes, again, longer travel, 120 to 160 millimeters of suspension travel, I think the 27.5 is the best wheel size. Most of the bikes coming out today in the trail bike category are 27.5. That's because, like I mentioned before, this chainstay can get really long the more suspension travel you add to a bike. So I think that your bike's going to handle better with 27.5 wheel sizes. Now, if you're very tall and you still want a trail bike, then 29ers are good. But, you know, for example, Giant made the Trance 29er for the past few years. In 2015, they're not making it anymore. That was their 29er trail bike. They only make it the Trance now in a 27.5. So wheel size does come into play when you're choosing between a hardtail and a full suspension. So that's going to wrap it up with my comparison of hardtail and full suspension. I hope that this video did help you if you're trying to decide which bike to get next. A lot of factors to consider, but hopefully some of the points that I made will steer you in the right direction. Thanks for watching.